Space Thunder Kids 2.0 managed to kill the invisible monster by fucking decapitating it with its secret weapon, a detachable head blade. But the movie doesn't even let the kids gloat a little, as it immediately cuts to another space dogfight. Between who, you may ask? At this point, do you really expect an answer? All that's known for sure is that you can add Space Cruiser Yamato and Battlestar Galactica to the list of things this movie steals from.
We're about halfway into the movie, and I just realized that you could fit all the dialogue spoken so far on a postcard. Well, granted, that may be a good thing since they only hired three different drama school rejects to voice all the characters.
We've been losing the war.
Is it just me, or does he sound a little proud of that fact? Talk about pessimism.
We've been losing the war.
And I have genital herpes.
Also, what the hell is up with those kids' eyes? They look like they're having seizures. Of course, if I had to stare at that dude's chimp-looking mug, I'd probably tweak a little too.
If you hadn't blacked out yet, you could probably predict that these kids are going to be piloting the last god mech, Tiger SX-3. But I bet none of you predicted that that same robot was going to be Daidenjin. Mainly because only three of you who watched this know what Daidenjin is. But also because the last time we saw Tiger SX-3, it looked nothing like this. But my favorite part of this whole scene is that once they all get inside the robot, they make the robot enter a ship, which it pilots. So they're basically piloting a robot that's piloting a ship.
It's like a Matryoshka doll of awesomeness!
We're heading right into battle with the Dark Emperor's army!
Rock, overcome your fear. Remember, the Tiger SX-3 is unbeatable.
Oh, I certainly hope so.
Ladies and gentlemen, the last hope for humanity!
Well, maybe not actually, because the next time we see them fighting the Dark Empire's forces, not only does the robot change to a Transformer knockoff, but the kids inside change too! I haven't seen continuity this bad since Turkish Star Wars, and no, I don't know why the mechs are using a ball and chain and an axe when they've got a perfectly good gun strapped to their backs. So, after an excruciatingly long fight sequence, Tiger SX-3 defeats the two mechs and an entire space fleet!
You know, I don't think it's the mechs that are so powerful they're able to pull off crap like this, it's just the Dark Empire is blazingly retarded!
Returning to the first team from way back at the beginning of the movie, it seems that Solar Mech 1 has run into some more ships from the Empire. But the mech just swats the ships down like they were flies, and in a show of unrestrained badassery, starts to battery ram the ships from behind, of course swapping color palettes between frames.
Okay, as much as I hate to admit it, this movie is awful. But it does have one, and only one, redeemable scene. Spoony, are you ready?
Fuck yeah, I am.
Behold.
That's the only weapon we've got. We should call Super Lynx to deal with them.
Owned!
This scene almost makes the movie worth watching, almost being the key word here. So, in a fit of desperation, the Fu Manchu general sends out fucking Raiden from Brave Raiden to fight Solar Mech 1. Of course, not Raiden's wimpy wrist blades are no match for Solar Mech 1's magically shape-shifting axe trident.
Now it's my turn. You can't get away from Solar Mech 1.
Wait a minute, who the fuck are these guys? Can the movie stop and focus on one group of people for more than 3 minutes?
After finishing off the rest of the fleet, Solar Mech 1 randomly teleports back to Earth to fight this completely unexplained robot enemy, and fucking pantses him in less than a minute in an extremely lens flare happy fight. And believe it or not, this is when the movie really starts to go batshit.
Just take a moment to let that fact sink in.
The movie cuts back to Tiger SX-3 as it fights yet another fleet of Dark Empire ships, but it's fucking hilarious because the ship they're flying in is somehow powerful enough to make an entire carrier explode for 30 seconds straight. Seriously, we've done nothing to this footage. This is exactly how long the ship takes to blow up.
All of this and they don't even have to get out of their spaceship. Is the Dark Empire even trying?
Meanwhile, on Earth, the Goiter General is back and he sees the opportunity to launch an attack while all of Earth's forces are out in space, so he orders his tanks to drive. And 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 drive.
And drive. Drive.
drive.
What, the director of a fetish for tanks or something? Nearly 2 minutes are spent just watching these tank driving loops. Worst of all, they never appear again for the entire rest of the movie. And oh, great, Sark is back. Oh, fabulous day. Could they possibly be more blatant?
So you finally got in here. Let's see how good you really are.
Stupid question, I know.
So for the next minute, the movie carbon copies Tron in a scene that'll have Bruce Boxleitner rolling in his grave. Someday. Fuck, Sark wannabe even de-rezzes when he's killed and... Wait, is that the Arcadia?
Fuck! They threw in Captain Harlock too?
Well, actually no. The Arcadia knockoff is piloted by some woman that sort of looks like Queen Emeraldus, only with a horrible Australian accent named, appropriately enough, Sheila, who has what looks like a Cabbage Patch Kid experiment that went horribly awry standing next to her. I'm sorry, but what in the hell is that thing?
Sandy, remember this, I'm doing this only because I'm your sister.
What?!
What does that have to do with anything?! How is that even possible?!
No! No. Movie's almost over. Let's just move on.
So, Sheila offers to help the Tron knockoffs with her space submarine, complete with torpedoes, periscope, and everything. You know, you'd think she would have someone else navigate through that scope or something. That eye patch of hers is doing nothing for her depth perception. Well, back at the Dark Emperor's ship, it seems that he's taken control of the MCP, and despite pretty much losing his entire army at the hands of the Thunder Kids, he seems convinced that he's won the day. If anything, you gotta admire his tenacity.
With the MCP under his control, the Dark Emperor declares that the universe is his and that no more direct conflict is needed. Which is why when the Arcadia rolls around, he screams out to his monkey-looking bots to attack. Yeah, I'm lost too. But before they get a chance to attack, the Arcadia scores a direct hit on the MCP, and the Tron knockoff destroys the Emperor with his totally not ripped off light disc. The end! Right?
Right?
Oh, come on, what else could there possibly be to show? Oh dear god, now it looks like they're ripping off G.I. Joe! Have you no shame, movie?!
Thankfully, the end is in sight, as the General, who looks like Sloth from the Goonies, is informed by one of his inexplicably green soldiers that the Dark Empire is no more. He surrenders, they shake hands, and promptly forget the fact that he betrayed the entire Earth and it led to thousands being killed.
That's right. No one will ever again use terrorism to try to impose their will on the whole universe.
I'm glad you feel that way. Now the process of rebuilding must begin. Let us structure a new universe with no weapons of mass destruction, and where the leaders bow to the will of the people, not the other way round.
Wait, what the fuck did he just say?
Sage, it's over. Just let it go.
Indeed it is. The three mechs that I'm sure are supposed to be the Space Thunder Kids watch as the ships blast off into space, and the movie abruptly ends there. No credits, no music. Just the words, THE END, on a red title screen, which is coincidental, because anyone who sits through this movie would already be seeing red!
This movie hurts.
It's not even a movie, it's an 80-minute endurance test.
With a movie like this, there's only one way to end this review.
And that is...
Don't know why he got told, it's just a bottle.